Today we're going to talk about a tuned collector oscillator, but before we do that, let's talk about an oscillator in general. See, an oscillator can be a source of an alternating voltage. You can have a sinusoidal output from an oscillator. Now, this sinusoidal voltage, you can see, is swinging from one direction to the other. Now, I'll just talk of another situation, though the comparison is not really very accurate, just to give you an idea of how an oscillator works. Okay, now for that rough analogy, suppose you're swinging on a swing, just like the voltage is swinging here. And do you think that these oscillations will go on indefinitely, or they'll gradually become smaller in amplitude and then die out? What do you think will actually happen? I mean, even your swing doesn't keep swinging, but after some time it just comes to rest. Now, if you want to keep these oscillations of the same amplitude, which means you want that the amplitude should not fall, and of course, unless we stop them, the oscillations should not stop. Then again, let's look at this. Let's look at the situation while you're swinging. You spot a friend and you just ask him that, can you just please push me so that I can keep swinging? So you need a friend to help sustain the oscillations of your swing. And your friend is actually supplying energy to you. The energy which you're losing may be due to different frictional losses. In the same way, in an electrical circuit, the oscillations will die down because of various resistances in the circuit. Like, you can have some real resistance, like for instance, if we have an inductor coil. Now, this inductor coil also has a certain amount of resistance in it. You can't have an ideal coil which has zero resistance. Then say you have a capacitor. Now, in the capacitor, you have a dielectric which is present. So, there will be certain amount of losses which will be present in the dielectric. Then you have the wires. Say you have an instance. Say I have this LC oscillator and you have the wires. Now, when an alternating current is flowing in these wires, you have electromagnetic waves which are radiated. So, in all these different ways, the system is going to lose energy. So, if the system loses energy, then automatically the oscillations will die out. Okay, now again, let me talk about your swing. See, just tell me something. Suppose your friend says, okay, I'll push you. Do you want him to push you continuously? Or you would say, hold on, only push when I ask you to. Otherwise, you're spoiling my rhythm. Now, this is exactly what we need over here in our LC circuit. We need to supply it with energy to keep up the oscillations. But at the same time, that energy has to have the correct amplitude and frequency so that the oscillations don't get disturbed. Neither do we want that the oscillations grow in magnitude. You know, you don't want that the oscillations start growing in magnitude. Nor do you want the oscillations decrease in magnitude and die out. You want that the oscillations stay at the same amplitude. This amplitude doesn't change, which means we need to provide energy to the system because the oscillations are going to otherwise die out. But we need to provide that energy in a way with the system in such a way that we get the desired effect. Now let us look at the oscillations and the sustenance of the oscillations in a more formal manner. See, the oscillator has mainly three components. One, this is the oscillator circuit. So we have a capacitor and an inductor connected with it. And this is also called a tank circuit. So, the LC circuit is going to produce the sinusoidal oscillations. Next, we have an amplifier. The amplifier will amplify the output of this tank circuit. In our case, the transistor is going to play this role. So, we have a transistor which acts as the amplifier. Then, we have a feedback circuit. Circuit from this amplifier is being given back to the circuit. So, this is a feedback mechanism over here by which energy will be given back to the circuit. This feedback in our case will be done by an inductive coupling, which is just like a transformer. So we have an inductive coupling between two coils which will give energy back to the circuit. See, this whole thing might sound very confusing to you, but once we look at the circuit, you will be able to understand. This circuit is going to create oscillations. This is as if you are swinging. This part of the circuit is going to amplify and give energy back to the circuit so that the oscillations can be sustained. The oscillations are maintained. So what we want to do is to be able to maintain the oscillations. Okay, now let's look at the circuit diagram and identify each of these three components in the circuit diagram. So this is the oscillator circuit over here. Let me just draw this. Okay, now this over here is the oscillator circuit. This is the LC circuit which produces oscillations, and the frequency of these oscillations is 1 by 2 pi under root LC. This is the frequency of the oscillations produced by this LC circuit. Next, we have the amplifier, and this transistor over here acts as the amplifier. The energy from this circuit is taken out, amplified, and it's going to be fed back into this circuit. So this amplifier over here is the transistor, but you know that a phase change of 180 degrees is introduced by a transistor. You've already studied this. So if this is the input, then the output is going to be amplified, but at the same time there's a phase change of 180 degrees. So now what we do is another phase change of 180 degrees is introduced by this inductive circuit, so that when the energy is fed back, it is in phase with the original voltage. And the final phase difference between the input voltage and the feedback voltage is zero. Remember, we said that the feedback needs to be provided at the right instance. You know, you have to push the swing at the correct instance. So in this case, we have a feedback which has a phase difference of 360 degrees or 0 degrees with the input voltage. Now we'll take a look at the working of this oscillator. When the supply is first switched on, there is some energy in the circuit in the form of electrical noise. You see, in this case, no external signal is applied. Whereas in case of an amplifier, we had an input signal and that signal got amplified. But in this case, there is no external signal. Now, the electrical noise comprises of this frequency that we want, which we will denote as F0, and other frequency components as well. But soon the circuit starts oscillating with its natural frequency, which is 1 by 2 pi under root LC. The voltage and the current both vary sinusoidally with this frequency. The magnetic field around coil L starts building up. Now, when this magnetic field builds up, it induces a magnetic field around coil L1. There is a flux linked, since you have an electric flux around this, that flux is linked with this coil, and since this is a changing magnetic flux, it induces an EMF. So due to that change in EMF, we have a change in current, and a change in the base current produces a change in the collector current. Now the collector current will reach a certain maximum value, which means the transistor is now saturated. Once it gets saturated, the current stops increasing any further. If the current stops increasing, then the magnetic field around the coil becomes static. The magnetic field stops growing. If the magnetic field stops growing, then the induced EMF also starts decreasing. So the current which was increasing now starts decreasing, and the transistor reaches a cutoff state, which means the transistor is now back to its original state, the state when we switched it on. Now this cycle repeats. The transistor changes from saturation to cutoff and then again back to saturation mode. And the output which we are getting from this circuit over here is oscillations which are steady. This circuit is called a tuned collector oscillator because you can see that the LC circuit or the tank circuit is present in the collector of this NPN transistor.